Welcome. We're going to talk about organizational problems today. Organizations face all sorts of problems, and in particular, organizations that don't work well together or have some internal functions, they may face reorganization. And what you see on your screen is essentially an organizational chart of the Department of Homeland Security. And you can look at the green ones; those are offices, individuals who are confirmed by the Senate. The blue ones are new offices or agencies that were created in the Department of Homeland Security. The light tan ones were organizations that were transferred into the Department of Homeland Security. And then these pink colored ones are agencies that report back to the Department of Homeland Security, but they're distinct. Now, why did we need the Department of Homeland Security? Well, there were some significant problems between communications between CIA, FBI, other intelligence agencies, and in order to help secure, the nation, we decided to reorganize because some of these weren't working well together. In doing so, we created a very, very large bureaucratic structure, and we moved agencies around. Where did we move people? Where did we? What organizations report to who? Well, those are all the political decisions. And so, however we structure organizations, we have to remember that this is political. If you have the ear of the president, if you have the ear of the governor, if, in other words, if there's just you and then the president, your organization and then the president, you're going to have his attention. But if you're like two or three levels down in the hierarchy and you have to report to two or three different other people before it gets to the president, you lose political power. And for example, you may be put into an organization that isn't as important in your eyes. When we do reorganization and when we try to readapt the mission of the organization or focus on some problems, we end up solving the same problems over and over again. And in doing so, we end up creating the same byproduct problems over and over again. And there's no real one way to fix all problems. This is really challenging because not all organizations function the same way. And we have to modify and adapt in order to make organizations function better. Now, Kaufman was an org theorist, and he was talking about how we make organizations function. He says, in order to have functional organizations, we need to have neutral competence. In other words, we need to have highly skilled employees who are insulated from political decision making that can undermine efficiency and leadership. So, in other words, the people who work inside organizations, they have to be highly skilled. They have to be able to make decisions that aren't going to be undercut at higher levels by political leaders. They're going to just do the best for the country at the best way they can. Neutral competence infers that the political affiliation of that individual doesn't really matter. They're just going to go in and do the public's best interest. So each organization should have that. Then they should have at the top an executive leadership. In other words, people who are elected, accountable to the citizens. And who are able to run these organizations according to political will. And they should be able to choose people and hire up leaders of positions who are loyal to them and help those organizations implement the laws according to the common interests of the citizens. So at the top we have, for example, a president, and then there's this layer of political appointees, and those political appointees run organizations such as the Department of Defense, Secretary of State, Treasury, all those other people there. They're politically chosen. They will rotate through as a new president comes in, as a new governor comes in, all those political appointees may switch out. What does that do? Well, it allows the organization to be led by the public opinion of the people, more or less, because they all have to face public pressure. Now, the third part of what Kaufman talks about is that the organization should be responsive to the people that it serves, as well as the legislature and their managers. In other words, the organizations need to adapt and change based on who they're serving. How they're providing service, the kind of oversight that they get from the legislature, because organizations need to be able to adapt in order to serve people's needs. So Kaufman talks about those three values as crucial parts of organizations, and some of them kind of contradict each other. Like neutral competence might clash against executive leadership or representativeness when the desires of the bureaucracy or the highly skilled technical people, they may not see. They may not want to respond to public demands because the public demands might not be reasonable or efficient or rational. So imagine we don't have an organization that's full of neutrally competent bureaucrats or skilled executive leadership or representativeness, and they start to become unaccountable. How do we fix an organization? Well, do we hire new staff to increase monitoring of the agency and keep the agency the way it is? Do we remove some of those leaders in charge of parts of the agency to make sure that the agency is responsive? Do we change the agency around and reorganize it so that different organizations respond to different other portions of the organization? Or do we set up some outside oversight committee, like a citizens oversight group, to make sure that the organization is doing what it's supposed to be doing? If you think about police forces in particular, we might remove staff. We might have more legislative meetings or city council meetings. We might have a police oversight board that comes from interested citizens. Sometimes we reorganize different departments so that they respond in different ways. This is a very, very common thing that we do in order to make sure that agencies and organizations are accountable and that they're doing their job really well. Now, this is not new. We do this all the time. We're trying to reorganize in order to make sure that there are efficiency gains and that they're that people are representative, the organizations are representative. Now, interestingly, as problems arise, we try to implement some of the old solutions, and those old solutions are well worth it. Some of the new solutions are well worth it, but we end up using sort of the same types of tools. As we try and focus on some new thing, some of the old problems are going to recur too. Well, why does that work? Well, because as we fixed the problem before, we shifted our focus. It causes a byproduct problem somewhere else. And so there's this constant attempt to try and fix organizations, and we end up cycling through some of the same problems and same solutions. Ultimately, inside every organization, we need better coordination. We need better coordination in the organization. We need better coordination with other portions of the government, different agencies. And what we're trying to do is integrate the operation of these different agencies, different branches of our organization, without sacrificing the expertise that's their very reason for existing. So, for example, we want to make sure that FEMA, Federal Emergency Management Agency, is doing its job really, really well, that it knows how to respond and how to prevent crises that occur when natural disasters happen. Well, if we move them around a little bit and we start changing who they respond to or how they respond, it might sacrifice their expertise. They might be focused on something new or shiny in, dealing with homeland security or dealing with, tornadoes or dealing with, terrorism. There's all these other things that as we start fo changing their focus, we might undermine the agency itself. So we need to coordinate, recognize legitimate reasons for organizations to exist, and then work with them to make sure that they maintain integrity inside the organization, but then are able to work to be responsive to some of the other issues that they deal with. So, as we start thinking about how to reorganize, we have to think about like what are the key things that we want to fix. We're going to talk about key criteria of good organizations. We'll talk about that in just a second. Inside, we also have agencies have interagency conflict. That's to say, there are problems inside agencies and there are problems between agencies. How do we solve that conflict and how do we increase coordination so we don't have to duplicate functions of government in different organizations and agencies so that we can increase efficiency but also work better together? And then ultimately, in the end of the lecture, we're going to talk about how staff works to resolve some of these problems to increase coordination and control agencies and coordinate their behavior. Now, when we talk about ways that we can fix organizations, what are the things that we want to do? Generally, there's a set of criteria that we try to work on. They're here on the left-hand side of your screen. We usually choose a reference point, say, hey, we need to fix this thing. This could be public acceptance, like a legitimacy, adaptability of the organization, making sure the organization is making consistent decisions. Maybe the organization needs more professional, skilled employees. They need to be more competent in training. Maybe we need to have an organization full of a more representative group of people. Like, for example, if my organization exists in a largely minority community, are the staff non-minority? And how's that going to affect the relationship between the community and the agency? That becomes a significant problem in our current day and age. How do we track records? How do we ensure privacy concerns, affect a database? How do we, decrease cost, increase performance and timeliness? How do we make ourselves more efficient? And then, ultimately, are we going to be more accountable to the executive, like the president or the governor or the mayor? Are we going to be more accountable to like Congress or the legislature or the city council? And are we compatible with state regulation? Now, I'm going to go back to this one about accountability to the executive and accountability to the legislature. When the president and Congress or the governor and the legislature or the city council and the mayor are at odds with each other, you cannot simultaneously become more accountable to like a mayor and a city council that doesn't want to do what the mayor wants, or a president and a Congress that don't want to do what the other one wants. For example, in the EPA, there have been times when the president really, really loves the EPA or really, really hates the EPA, and Congress really, really loves or really hates the EPA, but they're exactly opposite. And the EPA ends up in this tug of war between what they should do, whether or not they follow their manager, who's the president, or they follow Congress, who authorized them and gave them power to function. So as we're trying to reorganize and make organizations better by making them more accountable, you face trade-offs all the time. If we're going to increase effectiveness and efficiency, the best way to do that is to quiet competing voices. But diversity is about including diverse voices and dissenting opinions and different ideas so that we can maybe come up with a better solution. That takes time, which is the opposite of efficiency. So if we increase diversity, participation, and accountability, then our efficiency is going to go down. If our efficiency is going to go up, we have to quiet some of those contrary voices. So as we try to reorganize and make these organizations function better, it's not like you can meet all these at once. So ultimately what happens is leaders say, well, what do we need to fix today? And they solve some of these problems. Some of these, for example, could occur when a police department has an incident where they, are abusing a minority community, or they've had a mental illness problem. They've had a shot, a police officer shot somebody else. And they say, oh, well, we need to increase public legitimacy, or we need to be more transparent. Well, as we do that, maybe we turn over power in our police department to a citizen oversight commission. Now we have citizens riding along with police officers, and the citizens are going to critique what those police officers are doing. Well, those police officers are going to slow down. They're going to make decisions more carefully and deliberately, but they're also concerned in their interactions with the public about the safety of the individual in their cop car. Maybe that's a police ride along, and that's going to change their behavior as well. So we've got, potential of all these weird things that we're trying to fix, and they've got these byproduct problems. Well, then the byproduct problem becomes an incident as well. Like, oh my gosh, they're really slow or they're wasteful. Well, okay, if they're going to be slow and wasteful, then we reduce the amount of time under oversight. As we do that, become less transparent. So as we start reorganizing, it becomes difficult to try and figure out how to solve all the problems at once. And we're kind of wandering our way to doing that. And as we wander, we stumble into new problems as we're fixing other ones. Now, part of, so that's inside an agency trying to reform them. Part of the conflict and coordination organizational problems is that each organization has a specific function and jurisdiction. That's given to them in law. It tells them what they can and what they can't do. We can go all the way back to rule of law and how important that is. Now, here's the interesting thing. Like, agencies can end up having overlapping jurisdictions. Well, how does that work? Well, it happens when an agency has a specific purpose, or it serves a specific client, and another agency serves that same client in a different way. And so trying to serve those clients or those citizens in different ways causes conflicts. And we'll give you some examples of that. But this interagency conflict just occurs naturally because agencies have different roles. They perform different functions. And so that's not inefficient, but what it does cause is it says, you have a legitimate role and you have a legitimate role. How can you work together? Well, there might be incentives for them not to work together. And we know that causes all sorts of organizational problems and conflict. So what we got to do is figure out how to resolve those things. We'll talk about some of those strategies. Let me give you some examples. Department of Homeland, sorry, Health and Human Services serves the general population through health research and health systems, financing. Department of Veterans Affairs serves veterans. Now, if we think about the bases of organizations, one of those was purpose. Purpose-based organizations serve a specific function. Client-based organizations serve a specific group of people. This is from a previous lecture. So Veterans Affairs deals with everything veterans. They know everything about mental health. They know about healthcare. They know about traumatic brain responses. They know everything about veterans and specific veterans' needs. Department of Health and Human Services does similar stuff, but they do it for the general population. So while the VA is serving the veterans and knows them specifically very well, Health and Human Services is charged to serve everybody. Well, what happens when we have veterans? Do we serve them through the Health and Human Services, or we serve them through the VA? Health and Human Services works on ordering flu shots. Do we have the VA order flu shots separately for veterans? How do we distribute healthcare? If a veteran is entitled to healthcare, they're generally served through the VA, but Health and Human Services provides healthcare as well. So, where do the veterans go? And if Health and Human Services says to the veterans, like, hey, we know how to serve you, can you do that? The veterans will say, well, we know these clients really well, and we have to be served in a different way that's better. VA does a lot of research implants and